760 quid a week. Yes, I would. You'd pay me 760 quid a week to fuck your husband. And I take out taxes.
Wow. Is he really that bad?
Oh, no. Small penis. It's not the size, it's what they do with it.
That's a myth.
No, it isn't.
So, Brad's got a small dick. You never told me that before.
No, he doesn't. I'm just saying.
If it's not the dick, then what is it?
It's just the... Just what? I'm tired, you know?
No, I think we've already established that I don't.
Well, some positions are a lot of work.
That's the price you pay.
I'm tired. That is all I'm saying.
For love.
I want to wear flannel jammy bottoms.
For companionship.
I want to binge watch Breaking Bad.
For having a gorgeous husband who loves you. Oh.
I just want my body to myself for a while.
Do you not, you know?
What? You know. No. You mean?
Yeah.
Every time.
Well, now you've really lost me.
Well, he makes sure that I do, which is very generous, but when I'm done first, it gets painful, and when he's done, it's just done, as far as he's concerned. He's about to go outside of the marriage, Alison, which, believe me, I am fine with. But I want it to be with someone that I trust, and you need a job, a better job, so why can't you just goddamn do this one goddamn thing for me, goddammit?
Okay. I'm not saying that I'll do it.
But?
I'm not saying that I won't. How would this work exactly?
Well, we could set up a schedule every week.
What? Okay. Positions.
Oh, well, we put the standard 3 in the contract, and anything beyond that, you don't have to pay.
Good, because I don't think I can get my legs behind my head.
I can shoot for knees by the ears, though.
What kind of, you know, landscaping does he like?
Well, clean. With, like, a lamp.
How does Brad feel about all this exactly?
Oh, he thinks it's a great idea. I mean, he always thought you were attractive.
I think I'm attractive.
Well, yes, especially since Weight Watchers.
Men like him don't normally think girls like me are attractive, Penny.
You're in a higher league than you think you are.
Thank you, I think.
And besides, when's the last time that you had a good roll in the hay?
A roll in the hay?
I bet it was at university.
I've had sex since uni, Penny.
Oh, yeah? When?
You don't know everything about my life.
Yes, I do. You tell me everything. Oh, I bet it was university. I bet it was Gavin, the geek.
Yeah, the one that you made me break up with.
Well, here's my chance to make it up to you. Don't you miss the physical intimacy with a man? Wouldn't that feel nice?
Why me, Penny?
Haven't I given you 1,000 reasons?
Well, it's not like he'll be shagging his secretary. The 3 of us have got history. What if it starts to mess with your relationship?
What?
You think that Brad might fall for you?
People bond when they have sex, Penelope.
Wouldn't you be more worried about the reverse?
So you're saying there's no way Brad could ever fall for someone like me?
Well, basically, yes.
There's no way in the infinite universe Brad would leave you for me if we became involved.
Oh, but it's not involved. It's a paycheck. And no, I'm not worried. Mating is an exact science.
Fuck you, Penelope.
What's wrong?
You're basically sitting there and telling me Brad would never fall for me because I'm too ugly for him. And you're still thinking that I'm going to do this.
Yes, I do.
You're stupid.
People like you need people like me to have any sort of meaningful social life at all. And you're getting the chance to fuck a guy you could never get on your own in a million years. And we both know that's true. Because I love Brad, but I just can't fuck him for a while. I just can't. And if I lose him because of that, it'll be all missed opportunity. I don't see why it's such a crime for us to acknowledge this. We all know it's true.
Okay. Here's the deal.
Okay, you'll do it.
Not under the current terms.
You're making a mistake.
Look, Penny. You are my best friend, and I love you, so I'm gonna tell it to you straight. You might think you're extending me this great opportunity here, but what you're forgetting is that there's a blessing in not being gorgeous. I have to work a whole lot harder at being a real human being. And it's become readily apparent that your husband is getting sick and tired of your high maintenance, shallow personality. Now, as I said, you're my friend and I love you. But I don't really like you all that much, and you've pissed me off enough today that I'm willing to show it to you. I will fuck your husband, if you'd like. But I'll do it because I want to, not because you pay me. I'll do it because I can. Just as long as we know who's doing who the favour here. We're still on. You bet.
Never know how much I love you. Never know how much I care. When you put your arms around me, I get a fever that's so hard to bear. You give me fever when you kiss me, fever when you hold me tight. Fever in the morning.
If you can just pop the check on the table by the door, and I'll see you next Tuesday. Bye now, bye! Robert Kendrick, lovely chap. Massive fan of Betjeman, hats and slacks, 50 sensibilities. Oh, he hasn't got over the end of it all one bit. Oh, he still longs for that soft twilight of a Surrey evening. Cricket on a warm afternoon. Cardigans, pims. He's quite the old romantic, actually. Demands that I recite Betjeman to him every time we have a cup of tea. Yes, Robert shares Betjeman's passion for the robust lady, the adorably strong tennis girl's hand. Well, I try my best, but I'm no Sharapova. It's so hard keeping the sanctions straight with all that flailing, and then when he demands that I climax on those bloody dentils, well, it's tricky business, I can tell you. But it is hard for him. Well, he despairs of his eldest Amber, who's doing some sort of gender politics nonsense. No, Robert can't understand all that. Yes, his education is more of a classical genre. Homer, Virgil, Plato, which I always got mixed up with Pilates, but they're totally different. Look at the time. Thomas will be here any second. I'd better start preparing the potatoes. Oh, it's Saturday morning, you see. Busiest time of the week for me. It's ever since that Saturday morning kitchen lot set up. It's been tantamount to an invasion. Delia was on, and now it's Jamie Oliver. Oh, the results for my boys have been disastrous. As soon as Nigella comes on, oop, television's off. Wives are suddenly not interested. Just as the hubbies want to indulge in a little gastro porn of their own. It's unacceptable. Disgusting evening. Ooh, look at her, Jane. She's so gluttonous, so greedy, feeding a big fat face. Oh, look. Take my next client, Thomas Bishop. Perfect example. He came to me last week while he's having his little postcoital cry that he likes. And do you know what he said to me? He said, Millie, do you know what? I said, no, Thomas, what? He said, I watched my wife orgasm last night, Millie. I said, why, Thomas, surely that is a good thing. He said, To a Marks and Spencer's advert, Millie! To a bloody Marks and Spencer's advert! Just as all this cream cheese was oozing out of her burger, she squealed. I've never heard her make that noise before. And they're right, you know, Millie. This is not just food. This is adultery. It's sad, isn't it? So I look after these lovely husbands. I take in the waifs and strays. I say, come on, come on. Come to Millie Fawcett Reeves. She'll wipe your furrowed brow, press your shirt, serve a Sunday roast and offer a good old-fashioned bonk. All within the hour. A traditional service at traditional prices. Anyway, due to Thomas's newfound gastronomic insecurity, his demands have become somewhat specific. At first, we thought we could combat the problem with a little role play, but the only costume we could find was a carrot, so we had to sort of topple me onto the bed, and well, penetration was a nightmare, so that ended quick smart. Anyway, Thomas decided that to triumph over food was simply not enough. If his wife lusted after grub, he must become said nosh. And there we had it! The breakthrough! He became the banger, and I... well, let's just say I've had mashed potato in some very funny places.
Just wanna try it on. I'm carrying a
Yeah, you were pretty drunk and he said he needs to talk, so...
What should we talk about?
Oh, before or after the fourth bottle of wine?
Oh, we had four bottles of wine.
Well, we had six, actually. Wow, you really start to loosen up after the four.
We didn't.
You know. Well.
Whoa, shit. Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. Oh, my pen.
What are they going to think of?
What are you talking about? You're a grown woman, and besides, I'd be more worried about your boyfriend.
Roger. Shit, Roger.
Oh. Well, don't worry. He already knows.
How does he already know?
Well, after bottle number five.
No, enough. I don't want to know. God.
Will you just relax? Everything is going to be fine.
Everything's going to be fine.
Everything's not going to be fine, Penny. We can't let anyone know about this.
Oh, well then you might want to call Roger about the video.
Video? There's a video. A video? What the?
My career.
I'm kidding.
That thing gets out.
I'm kidding. I took the battery out of the camera before I even got here.
Roger was here.
Well, yeah, you called him.
Look, Penny. I'm not like that. I like men.
Oh. Honey, I know that, and besides, you're Roger, he's a real killer!
I think it's best that you just go, please. Just...
Okay, I will. But I'm gonna need my pants back.
What the?
I'm just kidding. Well, I'm not, but I'll get them another time.
Me too. we went for a swim and went our separate ways.
It's what you do. It's what you see. I know if I'm haunting you, you must be haunting me. It's where we go. It's where we'll be. I know if I'm hard to you, I'm hard to you, hard to you, you must be hard to me.
Death.
and then unlocked me, like a door that had never been opened by a master that knew the sanctity of what had remained hidden. To you, and for you, I gave up my secrets. You didn't take them. I gave you what was sacred. The sun shattered and everything was black. The beast in you was calm. I felt your life in me as you exhaled. You were heavy in my arms. On the day they found me, I was lying on the cold stone, eyes wide open, where you left me. Chain through the handcuffs and a knife in my back. He took me upstairs. He took all my clothes off with the knife. Do you know what you are? You're the devil's spawn. Nothing more than a dirty prostitute. Now get on your knees and say sorry to God for what you are. I knew if I argued back, it'd get worse, and it was going up and up in scale, so I did what I asked. I kneeled and I said, "Sorry, God." Then he boots me. Not sincere enough. Do it again. Burnt the cross in my back. Burn 17 crosses in my back. Break me 3 times. Then he went completely calm. I'm looking up at him. My jaw is shattered and my nose is gone. He said to me, "Calm down. Whiskey, cigarette." I was like, what is happening here? And then he said to me, "Ali, you've seen my face, so you'll be able to identify me. So I'm gonna have to kill you. I'm gonna go into the kitchen and get a knife and I'm gonna kill you." "Well, mate, if you're gonna kill me, I'll kill myself first. I'll kill myself first." I jumped out the window. 3 floors up. Shattered my ankles. There was a taxi driver going past, and he stopped and wrapped me in his coat and took me to the hospital. I didn't speak for 11 days. 12 hours that man tortured me. And the Crown Court, they took it all the way.
And they said, if I'd have been a normal woman, he'd have got 15 years in prison. Because I'm a whore. It's the hazards of the job. My face was plastered all over the evening news, so I knew I had to tell my mum. I rang her and she just said, get in a taxi. When I got home, she just held me. That night, my mum and dad took me to the local pub they'd been drinking in for years. Just so that they could say, this is our daughter. And that's okay.
We need to learn to think like men. Now get your shit together, we're going out.
You have to kiss a few frogs to find your prince. Now get back in that pond.